It's the middle of the night and I'm drifting over hundreds of meters of open ocean. And below me, trillions of deep sea creatures are making their way up to the surface to feed. This is the biggest migration on Earth.
My mission is to dive and drop spy cameras over the reef, the sandy drop-offs, and eventually the abyss, in search of the strangest deep sea creatures that nobody ever sees, documenting how they're uniquely adapted to hide, hunt, and kill.
Now, whilst almost all life in the ocean eventually ends up here on the reef, most of it starts its life out there in the darkness.
Like these Indian lionfish that are born into the world looking like this.
And this guy will be a voracious reef predator when he gets a little bit bigger. If you're a little fish, this is your worst nightmare.
Many of the weirdest creatures will never make it to the reef though.
But in order to find these creatures, we've got to swim out into the blackness. Whoa, what is that thing? It looks like some kind of fireworm.
Fireworms are venomous, armored with hundreds of stinging spines that they inject into the mouths of predators that try to eat them. As adults, they develop bright coloration as a warning. However, in their larval phase, they're completely transparent. But they also employ other tactics to avoid detection.
So you can see that this fireworm balls up when disturbed or illuminated by the lights to make it more difficult to spot.
A very smart strategy in a sea full of predators.
What on earth just happened there? Oh, that is weird. It wasn't me, I promise.
However, during the full moon, the bright moonlight pulls other worms up from the deep ocean, and many do not share the fireworm's concerns.
Oh no, the worms are coming in hot. Oh no, they're everywhere. Get away from me. Gotta watch out here or they're gonna go in my ears.
And as if the worms weren't bad enough, we were being followed.
Oh, we're being stalked. What was that? I can also hear dolphins up there somewhere, but I can't see them, which is pretty creepy. Now, almost all of these planktonic creatures are highly adapted for life in the open ocean. The most obvious thing is that they're all transparent, and they do this to avoid predators. A lot of them also spend their time closer to the surface where more light is scattered. So if you're a predator looking up like this, you'll struggle to see them. By the same logic though, I should probably be looking down to make sure there's no predators looking up at me. Ah, it does not look good down there.
However, not all creatures trying to survive in the blackwater are invisible.
Oh, look at this fish. Don't swim towards the light. This appears to be a small cardinal fish. And this is very much a reef fish. You can see he's still displaying some transparent properties. Is incredibly reflective. He's almost blinding me, blimey. So this guy is probably in between his planktonic phase and his final reef phase. And he's picking up the faint sounds of the reef and heading over there to join his adult counterparts.
But whilst a lot of larval fish display negative phototaxis, they're conflicted because they also display positive thigmotaxis, a strong desire to be close to surfaces. And some took a liking to our camera lenses. However, not all of these fish have a prey mindset. I believe this is a juvenile barracuda, backed up by the fact that even at just a few centimeters long, this individual was scared of absolutely nothing. He was probably already thinking of all the terror he's going to cause on the reef, if he makes it back there. Although, he's not short of things to chase in the blackwater either.
Oh, that's a crazy little shrimp. But you can see this one has some sort of paddle-like appendages. I'm not entirely sure whether it keeps them to adulthood or not. It may be an adaptation that helps them stay afloat in their planktonic form so they don't sink to the ocean floor. Creatures that drift around in the blackwater are always thinking about how to conserve energy. So all of these open water planktonic species have very high surface area to volume ratios, which means they don't sink very easily. A lot of them have gelatinous bodies or frilly appendages and cilia, which basically means that once they've made the effort to swim up to the surface layers, they don't sink back down too quickly.
Many critters in the blackwater eventually lose their planktonic adaptations, though, and have limited time to find structure to cling onto before they sink into the abyss.
Oh, what is that? Oh, yes! So this guy is a tozuma shrimp, and he's shaped like this to help him blend in on the ocean floor to whip corals, fans, and sea pens that he can hide on. Although, out here, his long, slender body and pink coloration don't seem to be doing too much for him, because he's pretty easy to spot.
But despite the open ocean being completely devoid of anything to hide on, some creatures get lucky.
Whoa, that's creepy. There's a massive root pier that's obviously holding one of the fish aggregating devices on the surface, just running down into the abyss.
Many creatures don't make it back to the reef, and instead live their entire adult lives clinging onto ropes or other structures like floating debris. These ropes were covered in shrimps and crabs, as well as parasitic fish species like fang blennies. They also provide a solid surface for algae, seaweeds, and hydroids to cling onto, creating a mini self-contained ecosystem that drops down many hundreds of meters to depths where creatures that fear our lights and bubbles are lurking. But in order to see these, we need a new strategy. Okay, so the problem with diving and trying to find stuff is that most of the planktonic creatures are very afraid of divers and very afraid of bubbles. So we're gonna send the camera rig down and we've rigged onto it two very powerful lights that basically act like a second moon. So hopefully we'll be able to draw some stuff in close, but let's get it in the water. Due to strong winds, the ocean surface was incredibly choppy, causing the camera to bounce up and down and spin around. So to avoid giving you severe motion sickness, here's a super quick highlight montage of what the camera recorded. Whilst the camera picked up many typical deep sea creatures, including large comb jellies, salps, siphonophores, and hordes of copepods and amphipods swarming the lights, the large beacon on top of the structure also attracted lots of fish species, like deep sea soldierfish, trevallies, as well as other highly reflective silverfish that most certainly gave themselves away after coming too close. However, alongside the fish encounters, the same green slime that followed us around on the dives also began to emerge. And it wasn't till the end of the final drop that we finally recorded the deep sea creature that was causing it. I believe this is a purple back flying squid, hunting prey items dazzled by our lights. We had a new mission. It was time to see if we could find one of these squids in the abyss.
So we're currently down at about 40 meters, which is about the same height as a 10-story building. And down here, it is very dark.
Down at these depths, there was squid ink everywhere. This mixture of melanin and mucus is ejected by squids, not only to avoid predators, but also to create a smoke screen that confuses prey as the squid attacks. And if they weren't already deadly enough, like other cephalopods, they're also able to confuse their prey further by changing their color using specialized cells in their skin called chromatophores. And these flying squids are voracious predators.
Whoa, look at this school of fish. Oh, there's some big squids down here. Oh, the squids are coming in hot. Oh, they just killed a mackerel.
Imagine how fast and stealthy you have to be to catch a mackerel in the pitch black in the middle of the ocean. So fast that our cameras certainly struggle to film the action. Life in the Blackwater is brutal, and as this mackerel disappeared down into the darkness, I'm sure the squids were waiting in the shadows to finish it off. However, not all cephalopods that patrol the Blackwater are at the top of the food chain.
Whoa, look at this little squid! He's hunting all the plankton that's just off the reef. He's incredibly fast though. We're having a hard time keeping up with him with the cameras. And you can see here that even though this squid is a predator, he's also completely transparent. He's in a true planktonic form. And that's because even though he'll grow up to be a fearsome plankton predator, at this point in his life cycle, he's on the menu.
But whilst this small squid is probably most concerned about being eaten by other larger squids, this tiny individual has many more predators to worry about.
Oh, what is that doing all the way out here? That is a crazy find.
The deep ocean is filled with all sorts of gelatinous deep sea creatures, all with their own unique weaponry. Comb jellies use sticky cells called coloblasts to entrap prey, while siphonophores deploy vast networks of stinging tentacles, enhanced with tiny lures, to disable small planktonic critters before consuming them. However, as is often the case, out here, many creatures are both predators and prey, and the siphonophores are not immune from being consumed. After some investigation, I believe this is a fish-shaped planktonic nudibranch, or sea slug, that preys on the gelatinous tissue of siphonophores. They also consume jellyfish.
Oh, nice little jellyfish with some long, stinging tentacles coming off of it. These guys are covered in nematocysts. Oh, and you can see how this one freezes when it comes too close to the light. This is probably a defense mechanism to make it harder for predators to spot it.
Many different species of jellyfish make their way up to the surface from the deep sea at night. Some have long stinging tentacles, others are more compact. Some are almost invisible, whilst others are more opaque. But all of them share the same anatomy, a pulsing gelatinous body that they use to propel themselves through the water and draw in prey to feed on. But whilst most gelatinous creatures hunt on the move, others use very different tactics.
We've got a very strange gelatinous creature here, and this one seems to have caught a jellyfish or a cone jelly. It seems like it's stuck in some sort of mucus field. Oh, and actually, if you look a bit closer, it seems like there's some sort of pulsating membrane inside. Perhaps it uses this as a lure to attract things.
This is a larvation, a planktonic animal more closely related to humans than jellyfish. Bizarrely, the small lure-like structure in the middle is actually the animal's body. The rest is a two-layered net that it uses to hunt. They create these intricate mucus houses around their gelatinous bodies to catch food. When clogged, which happens very quickly, they abandon their net and create a new one. However, this larvation definitely doesn't win the award for the strangest looking creature in the abyss.
Oh, what on earth is that? It looks like a swimming turd.
And the deeper we went, the stranger the creatures got. Larval barnacles drifted at the mercy of the currents with their frilly filters extended, competing with sea butterflies to catch tiny prey items pulled up by the strong upwellings. Larval crabs or megalopa jetted around furiously before balling up at the slightest sense of danger, undoing the last few minutes of work, jetting towards the surface. Other crustaceans, like the numerous mantis shrimp species, are much less concerned by the light though. Many swarm it, and others lunge towards it. This one is possibly a pink-eared or peacock mantis, a planktonic clubbing mantis with spherical eyes. Others, armed with sharp appendages, are more likely spearing varieties.
Oh, what is that? I have got no idea what that thing is.
This is a pyrozoa, a colonial tunicate made up of thousands of tiny individual animals called zooids that embed themselves into a gelatinous tube. Pyrozoa means fire body, a name they get from their ability to glow in the darkness. This tunicate is a salp, and unlike the pyrozoans, salps are often solitary. This one has managed to find some company, however, in the shape of a larval trevally hiding inside the salp's gelatinous body for protection. Other trevallies, though, are not so fortunate.
Whoa, little trevally! Yeah, you're a long way from home, mate. I'm not sure where he's off to. He's looking for some structure or somewhere to hide.
Miles away from shore, and even further from the reef, we were surrounded by creatures that live their entire lives in the open ocean, and those that remain hopeful that at some point they'll be pushed towards the reef. Many familiar reef creatures go through remarkable transformations when evolving into their adult forms, and what we found next is no exception.
Oh, what is that? Oh, it's got an eyeball. Is it some kind of fish? I think it's some kind of eel. Yeah, it is definitely an eel. Perhaps even a planktonic or larval moray eel. And if so, this guy will be listening out for the sound of the reef. Oh, another eel!
Larval eels are almost impossible to identify. It's difficult to know which of the many reef-dwelling eels this one is, and whether its adult life will involve picking off small crustaceans or dominating the reef as an apex predator. However, the one thing all of these eels have in common is that they started their lives out here in the darkness. If you loved this video, make sure to hit that subscribe button. And if you're in the mood for more ocean adventures, you'll probably like this video.